Welcome to episode 63 of IT Idiots. My name's Nicholas Hill.
I'm Nicky Curtis.
And this week we're going to be looking at... Well, what are we going to be looking at this week, Nicky?
We're going to be looking at a bit more Exchange
2007.
Wahey! Wahey!
No, I meant that in a great way.
But well, it's time we did... I think it's time we did a bit of a techie one, I think.
It is.
A little bit. But it's not going to be that technical because I haven't had much time.
No, but it's going to be looking at cutting-edge technology.
It is.
Exactly, and that's what counts. Talking of cutting-edge technology, Nicky...
Oh dear, where's this going?
No, I was... What do you mean, where's this? This was going to be a great lead-in and link-in to the great people over at i3Q. I thought this would be a great time to take a little bit of a commercial break.
Yeah, thanks to the guys at i3Q, again, for helping us run the podcast.
It's absolutely.
Really appreciated. And it's nice to know that, you know, people like what we're doing. I'm really chuffed with that.
So
cool. I haven't chatted to the guy yet. You've spoke to him, haven't you?
I have, yeah. Cool. But you've ordered your Porsche. No, not quite that kind of level of funding, but still very generous indeed.
Yeah.
So i3Q for really all of your IT requirements.
Exactly.
Check them out. You never know, they might actually be able to do something for you.
I'm sure they do Exchange.
I reckon so. Probably better than we do.
Yeah. I'm getting very scared now.
Right, so that was that. And what was the other big one that happened this week?
Yeah, this week. Well, yeah, sorry for not doing many podcasts recently, but, you know, and I hate saying we've been busy because, you know, when people say, oh, I'm busy, I think, yeah, right.
Yeah.
But, yeah, we haven't had the chance to do any, but hopefully that will come back on track. And whilst we've been away, it got, you know, we got some nice reviews, and we hit a top 10 list from this guy. Who's he? No, you wanted to say the name.
Jaime Henderson.
Don't say that. He put us, well, he's got a top 10
Jason
podcast.
Jason Heiner, I'm going to pronounce it. I could be wrong. But he's an executive.
He's an
editor.
Executive, so he must be good.
But I've always rated his work.
Yeah, and he's put us as number 10 out of 10, but he's put us first in there, so presumably that was a mistake on his part.
No, it's deliberate because he's trying to push us really as actually being the best show.
No, I mean, he's got the numbers wrong.
You're rambling. He's right. He's right.
I do ramble, but...
So anyway, we made top 10, and that was nice, because we picked up a few thousand, I reckon we picked up another few thousand viewers.
We did, yeah. And it's really funny, because our website's, well, it actually coped reasonably well, didn't it?
Website didn't go down.
Yeah, no.
I'm not complaining.
Well, I've had a few issues with the downloads.
Oh, have you? When?
Yeah. What? When today? I released, no, it's been
But guys, we are now serving up some serious... frigging bandwidth.
I know, we need another server.
It's frightening. I'm not quite sure. I just ignore the fact that it's not going to cope off one server for much longer.
Oh, the Apple TV thing. Should we mention about the Apple TV? Yeah, we're getting some really bad feedback about the Apple TV thing. Yeah, and I'm sorry, but we don't have an Apple TV, so it's hard for us to test.
And nobody offered to give me one after my email apologising.
And plus, for the person who was quite rude at you, Nick, we've never said it was an Apple TV compatible. It's HD.
Yeah.
It's Apple bloody putting us in the Apple TV section. So it's their fault.
You're kind of right. We will get it.
We should get it right.
I mean, the one that's up there now, I fixed it, and I re-uploaded it, and I fixed the iPod. But I was exporting it from a different application, so... where I had my presets done. So it was my fault, but I didn't check either of them. And so, but that was the Mac show anyway.
Was it?
Yeah, these people don't watch the Mac show. They're not trendy enough.
Okay. They haven't switched yet.
So that was that. What else can we ramble about?
I don't know. Well, let's have a quick look on the forum, see if there's anything interesting going on the iTunes forums.
Forum questions. So you had one that you liked.
How do you mean?
Well, somebody asking what podcasts we listen to.
Oh, yeah, there was...
I thought that was a pretty reasonable question.
Someone's posting, and I think this might be useful, because if you're new to podcasts, well, probably not. Well, if you come across this first...
But the number of people that watch us on the website, I think, have no idea that they can download
this. Yeah, that's true. There's certainly a difference in people who come to the website and watch the viewing, and I think lots of people don't realise we're in downloadable format on iTunes, so...
This really affects the Windows people. And for next week's show, I thought if we do a little light-hearted follow-up with the Asus E, I'm going to show Get Miro, because it's perfect, isn't
Miro's
it?
For
Windows people, it's perfect who haven't got an iPod. And I think maybe we'll show that, because I think that's a perfect way to get our podcast, isn't it?
I think so, yeah. So what tech podcast do you like the next? So,
well, I actually bothered replying.
Well, I was going through busy, so you got Jonathan. Okay, yeah, I listened to Jonathan Ross. It's not a tech podcast, though, Nick, is it? You didn't read the question.
No, I know, but that's why I then put these ones, because I don't listen to... I only listen to three tech ones.
So you've got...
More business-related.
Cranky Geeks is pretty good. I enjoy that.
Oh, I do. I rate that
one,
show.
The one that you haven't got on there, which I quite enjoy, and I know you have issues with it, I think, is Buzz Out Loud. I like Buzz Out Loud, because it's nice and technical. It's a little bit tech. It's 30 minutes. It's every day as well.
Yeah.
So I can listen to it commuting. So I do like Buzz Out Loud. Twit, I don't actually listen to Twit anymore. I used to really like Twit, you know, I really did. They were really good team.
Well, when it was technology-based.
It was technology, and now, you know, and I'm not saying they're bad and all, because some people like to listen to people rambling, like we're doing now, but that's all it is now. It's just people rambling, isn't it, about their personal experiences with Apple and stuff, and I don't find that particularly...
And there's a lot of repetitive conversations.
Well, Twit, Mac Break, and Windows Weekly.
We are knocking the biggest podcasts out there. So
no, it's just opinion. It is
opinion.
They're better than us. Well, more downloads than us. But yeah,
that's... And the rest of mine are business related. But Friday Night Comedy, even if you're in America, you guys have got. It's
is that the channel for the Radio 4 one?
Radio 4 Friday Night Comedy, and it's the Now Show is back this week.
Okay,
and it's nice because it's just they call it Friday Night, so uh-huh. As the shows change, because I guess they run for like 6 episodes or whatever, right. You just always subscribed. So what? I mean, what else do you subscribe to? That's
well, we could actually have a look, couldn't we? shall I load up iTunes?
No.
Right, I think that's right, about it. The ones I definitely listen to, Buzz Out Loud. Mac Break Weekly I do listen to, which is, again, from the people at Twit.
So that was our new section, Question of the Week.
Question of the Week. Any other things we can answer quickly on this? No, I think everything's been answered.
Yeah.
Stream video over LAN. This guy wants to stream video to 400 people. Talking about Windows Media Services. Windows Media Services, you can stream with it. I mean, what we do is Nick encodes to Flash, don't you?
I do.
And you can just stream Flash and, you know, you don't need much of an infrastructure for that.
Yeah, but I'm listening to Steve this week. Flash is crap. It's not where the future is.
I know, yeah.
Let's not go there. Okay. So right. You'll cover that in an episode, will you? We'll set up 400 little computers, 400 little virtual machines that we'll all stream to. Right. So what are we doing this week? Come on.
We're rambling.
Keep it snappy.
We've got to ramble. Right, so we're doing Exchange 2007 this week, and what it's about is high availability. So how many episodes have we done now? Three episodes.
Well, I guess it's on all the torrent sites. Is that not what we mean by high availability?
Lost is quite...
right, so what
does it... 4 minutes came down in.
What what does high availability mean?
Okay, so we looked at an Exchange server. Now, Exchange, your email system's line of business, so if it goes... If it breaks or the server crashes, then you've lost your email, and to some organisations that's a bad thing, and they're shabby.
Exchange
high availability. So yeah, we're going to deal with
no, you were explaining what high availability means. I've got Exchange, if it goes down important, it's not very full available. Business okay,
yeah, so
if mine goes down,
if yours goes down, you could potentially lose money, couldn't you? Certainly my organisation, if our mail server went down, that wouldn't look good being an IT services company. So no. We need to make sure that it's highly available.
Okay.
Now, what we're going to do is just recap on Exchange 2007, because it's been a few weeks, looking at the different roles of Exchange 2007. I've got prepared slides.
I'm just thinking,
there's no more slides after this.
I was going to say, people are saying WTF at home. They're sitting there saying exactly that. What's Nicky done?
So role review, then we'll have a look at high availability solutions for each one of the roles. Remember, Exchange is split up into roles, so we'll look at how we can make it high available for each one. And then we'll have a look at high availability for the mailbox role, which is SEC, LCR, SCR, CCR, and I'll explain about them when I get
there. Sounds great. It sounds expensive to make all this work.
Oh, well, that's where maybe you're wrong. Because normally you might have to employ third-party solutions to get this sort of level of availability, like Double Take or... something else, I can't remember. There's various third-party solutions. So let's have a look at a role review, and I'm going to do this just by popping up my Exchange environment.
Very nice.
And where is it? Where's my RDP? There it is. And it's all running on my other machine, my Windows machine. That's why you can see VMware Workstation. And we're hosting it on the Mac just because we've got the capture software works well on the Mac.
And for editing as well.
And for editing, it's easy. And it's Friday night. So don't use PCs at work, do we? Right, so let's have a look at the roles. The mailbox role, do you remember what the mailbox role does?
Is Shabby going to use that PC?
You can't use that PC, dude.
Okay.
Okay. The mailbox role.
Right, the mailbox, yeah.
It holds your mailboxes, yeah?
Yeah.
So that's pretty much all it is. The mailbox role holds your mailboxes. It can't do anything else. No. It can't provide access to users, apart from for MAPI clients.
Right.
It can't send email.
No.
In order to send email, we need the hub transport role.
That's right.
Okay. So the hub transport role is responsible for sending email to between recipients, even if they're in the same mailbox role the mailbox server.
Yeah.
So if I'm the mailbox server, mailbox role, and you're the hub transport role, and both the mailboxes are here, if I send an email message to a recipient that I've got here, it'll go via you and back again. But that's good, because remember, because Nick can apply transport rules to it.
Ah, that's the one.
So hub transport server, if you go down, we've lost messaging in our organisation, no one can send email.
We're losing money.
We're losing money. So what do you think we could do?
Have two hub transports.
Yeah, absolutely right. Do we need to do anything more complex than that?
Probably not, because it's Microsoft.
You don't. It's amazing. It's amazing. The ability, you just have a couple of them. That's all you need to do. And remember, these roles, they could all be on one server. They could be different servers.
Can you have one server that would pop into life and take on any one of those roles if it needed to?
Now, that's when you're going to need to have
six
a third-party solution. But, you know, just virtualize it and have, you know... Well, no, because then you
have it running on the old Mac that you don't use in the corner.
Exactly, on your Mac Mini or something. Right, so that's your hub transport role. The client access role, you can probably guess what that does, isn't
it? It accesses all your clients.
It's the access to the mailbox from your clients.
Yeah.
So if you're using Outlook Web Access, I want to access my mailbox. I communicate as the Outlook Web Access client with the client access server, and the client access server communicates with
the. Is that the one that's got
server.
The read-only copy of AD?
No, that's the Edge. That's the Edge transport server, which is very similar to a hub transport server.
That was it.
Because it's sending emails. But look, client access is just about client access, not message delivery.
Okay.
So POP3 clients, IMAP4 clients, and Outlook Web Access clients. So, Nick, if I lose my client access server, potentially...
Well, I guess it's...
POP3 clients, they're not going to work. IMAP4 clients, no, not many people use those nowadays.
Mission critical, then.
Well, let's say if I was at work... and we lost the client access server role, I, as an internal user, will be able to send email messages to everyone else because I use Outlook at work. And
right.
Outlook is slightly different because it doesn't use the client access server.
Right.
It interfaces directly with the mailbox server.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And however, now when I'm at home, you've probably heard of Outlook Anywhere or what's it called? It was called RPC over HTTPS.
Right.
And that enables me to use a feature-rich Outlook client at home and communicate into my office. Now that uses the client access server.
Okay.
So if you lose the client access server, you will be badly affected, you know, because you...
Oh, okay.
Because I say so. So how can you have more of them?
Well, I don't know. Just run two copies.
Have two of them. Now, you've got to have to think about this now, because if we have two client access servers...
Yeah.
Now, remember with Outlook Web Access, when I type in mail.itedits.com, that resolves to an IP address, doesn't it? It goes to that one.
Ah, so you've got to have a proxy that's going to detect which one. Yeah, and then if one's down, it'll relay it over to the other one or something.
Something
like
that.
That.
Yeah. Yeah, something like that. So what we want to do is sort of
but
balance
that you
would
take
load balance.
Oh, you're actually going to load balance.
Network load balancing. We could put two client access servers in a network load balancing cluster and give them a shared IP address.
And I guess also if you were a truly global company, you could also direct them if they were closer to London or closer to New York as well.
Generally speaking, you
and
would have...
London would be a failover if New York goes down or something.
Exactly. It's kind of interesting. If you are a global company, where do you put your client access server?
In the middle
and
of the ocean.
Normally what you want to do is put them close to the mailbox server.
Right.
And you would direct the US users to the American CAS and the UK users to the UK CAS. But that, of course, is up to you. It's your design and your network infrastructure you've got to look at. So the client access server, we can have multiple of, and we would have to use, or you wouldn't have to, but you'd probably use network load balancing, which is a Windows feature, to make it easy for your clients.
Okay.
You know, so that's that. So they're quite easy. Unified messaging, I'm not going to go through. That's a massive topic, and we might do a whole podcast on that one.
I think it deserves it.
I hope so. And the Edge transport server, have more of them. Remember what the Edge transport server is responsible. It's responsible for sending email to people on the internet and receiving email from people on the internet.
Now with clever editing. Is that the one that has the read-only copy?
that is correct. So now the Edge transport server, let's think about it. Now when people are sending email into your organization, it goes to the Edge and back again. So if you have two of them, mm-hmm. you need to make sure that people in the outside world are aware of those two.
Right.
Now that can be done with MX records. Do you remember?
Yeah.
We could say itedits.com, mm-hmm. MX10, go to that one, MX10, go to that one, and it will actually load balance between them.
Oh, okay.
And if one goes down, of course, it won't be able to communicate with one of them and it will go to the other one.
Uh-huh.
So that is the Edge server.
But you need pretty clever hardware to do the load balancing for
it. It is a Windows service.
Oh, you do as a Windows service.
It's a Windows
now.
Service, yeah. Okay. I've got to say this at this point now because I noticed Microsoft's getting a lot of stick in the forums, you know, stick it to the man and all this kind of nonsense. But you know, their products, Exchange 2007 and Windows 2008, are so impressive. I think they're really good. Vista's shite still, but on the back end, I think that things are going really, really well for them.
But I mean, that's just what we call the sort of the high visibility public talking about Vista because they see it and they're using it at home and it gets a lot of conversation. I mean, what you're talking about here is real professional sort of...
Yeah, and if you look at things like IS6, it actually claimed back market share from Linux when it went with Apache, and it didn't have one critical update during its product life, and no one ever talks about that. They're always negative towards Microsoft. But it's good. I just feel... I don't know, I just look at Apple sacking Luke. Do you know what I mean? That's all I see. And I see Microsoft thanking me for what I do. Do you know what I mean? So that's Hub Transport. So we get onto the mailbox now. So the mailbox is slightly different because I can't just have two mailbox servers because your mail or your messages are going to be on one server or the other. Yeah. So if that one goes down, I've got a mailbox server there, but it's gone down here with my mail, hasn't it? So we need to find a solution for mailbox service.
But would you have something in the back end that's collating and looking after everything? Or would that just be too messy? Or do you use replication between
the replications? That's exactly what you're doing. That's what we're going to look at now. Mm-hmm. So let's go back to this slide.
The one that he spent so long preparing.
I said I'd do some slides. You said you'd be an hour. I'm quite slow. And so we've got various options, this SCC, LCR, whatever.
SCR.
They're all availability solutions for the mailbox role. So let's start off with LCR, local continuous replication.
Is that the first one? Is that the one you can currently remember?
No, we've actually configured LCR in one of the previous episodes. This is where you've got one server, your mailbox database is on, let's say, one disk, and it's replicating across another disk. Now, of course, that's not going to deal with a server failure, but a hard disk failure it would be fine with.
Okay.
So if we wanted to deal with a hard disk failure, how do we do that? Well, we use standby continuous replication. And that's where you're the standby server. I'm going to replicate the mailboxes or the messages across it. Remember, it's a database. So it's just like SQL replication. Everything comes in as a transaction. I replicate the transaction to you, you apply it to your copy, etc., and brings you up to date. So that's SCR. That's SCR. I'm going to have to double check this, Archers. The other one is SCC, single copy cluster.
Single copy cluster.
This is very much the old way of clustering. You can still do it.
Old school.
The downside of SCC, if you imagine we're a cluster next, so I'm the active node, you're the passive node, and if I die, you've got to be active, and if I die, that sounds sad, isn't it? But the downside of an SCC, single copy cluster, is we've got to use a shared disk.
Okay.
And it's not good for, well, I want you to be in Ashford, and I'm going to be here, and I want to... Well, a single copy cluster, you can't really have a stretch cluster. Well, in actual fact, you can have a stretch cluster, but you've got to be configure this all in your VLANs, etc.
It's going to be very slow.
People do it, but it's not ideal because what we've got at the moment is this one, CCR. Cluster Continuous Replication, I believe it is.
Continuous Cluster Replication.
Or something like that.
Right.
Something like that. And this is Service Pack 1. You need Exchange 2007 Service Pack 1 for this. Okay, now what this enables us to do is we can work as active and passive nodes, but instead of sharing a disk, what I do is I replicate, I get messages in, written to my transaction or applied to my database, I replicate the transaction to you and you apply to it.
Yeah.
So, and that's the way, that's pretty much the way it works. Now, when you look at a transaction log on Exchange 2007, they're not 5 meg anymore, they're 1 meg, so that these things can complete and copy across to you.
But, I mean, you're talking about constant working. I mean, if you think about the amount of mail that these boxes can handle.
You're absolutely right. But if you look at the utilization of a server, you might be surprised. If you look at the hard disk on a server, you might be surprised. And what you would do is you would design with that in mind. Because it's the first thing that I would thought of, that I actually thought of, thinking about this replicating, I'm sure it's got to slow it down.
Yeah.
And
you'd be amazed as to how much you can actually pack into such a small amount of...
Yeah.
No, interesting, because you'd have just thought for large organisations where your mail server can actually handle quite a lot of clients, especially when you consider the amount of shite that's coming into people's mailboxes.
Exactly, that's why you spec up the solution to be able to deal with this, because your availability is so important, but you're absolutely right. Now, the interesting thing now is we can, for example, I could be using local copy replication. You can mix all of these. I could be using LCR to my second disk and using SCR to but the issue with it, the nice thing about CCR is you get the automatic failover because it uses the actual clustering services, the Windows clustering service.
It's dizzy. It really is dizzy, the thought of all this. I mean, we've got 5 users in our office. and we'd probably do 100 emails. The thought that you'd replicate 100 emails in a day between two servers.
Well, if you think about it, it just comes crazy. In, writes to there, and gets copied across. You
know, 100 emails a day?
But not even I get that. Right, so that's, again, new for Service Pack 1. Now, what you've got to think about is this. Well, let's say we're in a CCR, and I'll show you this in a second. We've implemented CCR, and email comes into me, gets replicated to you, fine, no problem at all. Now, if an email comes into me, it gets stored on my machine, and let's say my transaction log hasn't filled up yet, and I've died, you know, my machine's just locked up. Well, I've got a transaction there which I didn't replicate to you.
Mm.
So have I lost that email?
But is it also being cached somewhere else until...
What is the role that is all that email is always going to go through?
The client.
The hub transport.
The hub server. Transport.
So we have something called a transport dumpster, which can...
Dumpster.
It's called a transport dumpster. So let's have a look at this CCR. We can do some failover testing. And let's pop to my VMware on here, and just to run through here, I've got three Exchange servers here. I've got my one DC, which is also running all the roles on here. So if I go to server configuration, I can see I've got DC1 there.
Yeah.
And that's hosting a fair amount of stores. And I've got this thing here called SID CCR1, which is my continuous cluster replication. Now, I'll just take you through the configuration of the nodes. Now, we've done a bit of clustering before, so you can recap on that video if you're not so familiar with it. And what I want to show you is where my mouse is.
Expand that one out, so might as well. That's it.
Screen sec. So we can see at the moment all this information store, everything at the moment is running on the node EX3, which is this machine over there.
Yeah.
So the information store system attendant, but it's no hub transport, we don't need any of that. And what I'm going to do is just go back to my configuration and let's have a look at the mailboxes I've got. So the administrator mailbox is on SID DC1. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to move that mailbox across to the new cluster.
Okay.
It's so easy to move these things now. So CCR1, we'll move it into there. And screen resolution issue. Next. Again, you can read through that. Pause it. Shabby. So we move the mailbox immediately. Of course, what you could do if you're moving 500 mailboxes, I might set that up and say, can you run it at 8 o'clock?
Right.
No, something like that. So that's next on that, and it's moving that across, opening source mailbox. I don't think there's much in there. You going to sing, Nick, or anything?
I'm trying to listen to Chevy's telephone conversation. Terrible. So how long is this going to take?
It won't take so long. And hopefully this demo would work, but again, it's all running on a laptop, this high availability solution. So I should cluster the laptop, shouldn't I?
High availability and low availability.
Right, so one succeeded. That all looks absolutely fine. So administrator is now on the...
And that's running on its battery as well, by the way.
No, it's not plugged in.
Okay, yeah, I can see it.
So let's just have a look at that administrator mailbox then. Actually what I can do is just load up Outlook, can I? Right, Outlook should be loading. Did I click on it now?
Yeah, I thought you did.
Maybe not. Okay, so Outlook is running. And I've logged in as the administrator, so we should see the administrator's mailbox.
So all of these virtual, all these machines are running on that one laptop?
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay, so I can see that the mailbox actually in there.
Yeah.
Now what I'm going to do is go to the Exchange server now, or EX2, sorry, and this is where the mailbox of that administrator actually is. And I'm going to just right-click on that just to simulate a failure. Now you could switch them off, but again, in this VM environment, it's not a good way to demo it because it often doesn't work.
Mm.
Because, well, it's limited resources, basically. let's right click on this and say move group. Now have a look at the information store, and they say they're online on EX3 at the moment. So they're actually on EX3 on that machine. So let's just move this across. It might just be I want to service pack EX3.
Right.
You know, let's do some maintenance.
Take it down just to do a bit of work.
Let's move it across. So online pending. So it's moving to EX2. And the great thing about this this continuous cluster replication is one node could be in UK and one could be in your DR site.
Right.
You know, and it's designed for that, effectively. Mm-hmm. And you don't have to worry about stretching VLANs and rubbish like that.
Cool.
You just want it's over, don't you?
No. I'm just following what you're doing. I'm trying to take it all on board.
Uh-oh. Okay, so one of them failed.
That's good.
It's not good. I'm going to bring it online.
In a way that's bad.
I'll be sure what that is. I'm going to look in Event Viewer just to see if there's anything.
Have you ever seen this kind of thing before?
Oh dear.
Quite a lot of errors. Log is damaged. Invalid or inaccessible.
I did a failover earlier. About then. I'd had a delayed write earlier on my VM.
Yay!
Now it's going back to EX3 now. I mean, typically what would happen is the group won't fail over. If it gets a failed, it just goes straight back again.
Of course, because it hasn't successfully been able
and
to.
Again, it's just a little bit slow, and I can see the hard disk light flashing away there.
Yeah.
I can't actually, I'm just lying for.
It's artistic effect. Understand? This is media, baby.
Come on, work, goddamn you. Hang on, can't you just scrub over pending it?
I can block that out. It well easy, mate.
Cool.
You wouldn't even notice, all online. It's the shabby effect, isn't it?
Okay, well, it's an episode if this doesn't work.
Damn it, you're watching this. We made it.
Yeah. But when I was playing with the laptop earlier, I had a VM delayed, right? Oh, look.
There we go. So that's genuinely online.
On EX3. But that's cool. I'll try it once more.
Yeah, it's worth trying once more. I mean, it's more the theory that...
Exactly.
I mean, just as I say, I can block that a little bit. That's easy, that one out, mate. Yeah. It's all just a bit of paint.
Lick of paint.
White paint, lick of paint, lick of paint.
That's 40 Towers, isn't it?
It is, yeah. You know there was a Father Ted 10-year reunion on filming of the last episode this week.
He's dead.
I know, but it was all... It was a one-week festival.
Okay.
Ooh, two, three.
Look at that. So, EX2. So
we're synchronized pleasure.
Right, so let's go to Outlook now.
Quick.
Now, with Outlook, you probably are going to have to close down Outlook and open it up again, it'd be fair. But the point is, you haven't lost your email.
No.
Outlook does some strange things. And remember, with Outlook, I'm using a cached copy of my mail as well. So this is why it doesn't look like it's...
done anything.
You might expect it to error or something.
Right.
But it doesn't. And I'm just going to load it up. And I'll send a new email message to myself just to show that that's working.
Wow.
It's been quite a long one, Nick, so far.
It has.
Well, we had a bit of waffle at the start, didn't we?
We did, but... What's 400 meg an episode?
Right, so administrator.
With part two files, that's about a 40-minute TV show.
Bye.
I got a great application for those, by the way.
For what? Right, so I sent my email. Why didn't I just stop there, Nick?
I have no idea. It would have been a great point.
It would come. There we go. Yeah, big fan. That's all come through, and I could fail it back again, but...
What's the point?
That's
what I like. We bring an upbeat, happy mood to Exchange Server at 9:30 on Friday night.
It is a Friday night, and we really should be out drinking or something. No.
No, not you. Not me. Not you. God, you were twittering as you were puking all the way through London, weren't you?
I don't Twitter.
You were. People just don't know what your proper Twitter account
yeah,
is.
Yeah, so if anyone saw me in London, I was yakking on Moorgate, Waterloo City, pretty much everywhere.
You're just wrong. You really are on so many levels. Right, okay. Say goodbye to the boys and girls.
See you next week.
See ya.
Well, see you next time.
Bye.
Bye.